les pressions directes qui opèrent sur la biodiversité
direct pressure exerted on biodiversity is of multiple origins. This kind of pressure has been well identified. The first direct threat is the transformation of habitats,
c'est-à-dire que des
natural habitats which were with a rich biodiversity are progressively changed into habitats which are increasingly artificial and poorer in terms of biodiversity. Deforestation, for instance, forests are being turned into agricultural ecosystems. What do we need to do to react to this threat? We have to take action, we have to fight against deforestation. In France, ecological compensation is being carried out. When a human infrastructure is being created, a motorway, an industrial plant, a factory, every time either it is necessary to protect the ecosystem, reduce the impact, or compensate for the creation by restoring an ecosystem elsewhere to make up for the creation of this new plant. Another direct threat is overexploitation of the oceans, of all the species present in tropical forests, leads to what we call free access. Unfortunately, these resources are open, there is no restriction to access, and therefore there is no virtuous cycle to avoid overexploitation. One essential solution to address this direct pressure will consist in regulating collective access to the common resources. Another type of direct pressure exerted on biodiversity is ecotoxicity, the fact that some polluting agents have effects on biodiversity, for instance, pesticides. One of the main issues of ecotoxicity lies in the fact that the effects, it could be acute ecotoxicity, for instance, and acute ecotoxicity, we try to avoid it by conducting laboratory tests, but these polluting agents can have long-term effects, which can only be visible after some months or maybe some years, and the effects may not endanger survival, but may endanger fertility. The toxic effect can also appear in combination with other polluting agents. Now, in this case, we have a methodology problem for scientists because it's very difficult to test the impact in the laboratory, which means that we have observed nature and find observation systems that are powerful enough so that we can assess ecotoxicity directly in nature. One system is developing right now which proves useful to assess ecotoxicity, participative sciences. Observers over the whole national territory monitor biodiversity everywhere. And once we have taken stock of the situation of biodiversity over the whole country, we can understand the direct effect of polluting agents and we can compare their impact with the impact of other polluting agents. Bird fertility is not only affected by polluting agents, but also other problems such as climate or environment artificialization or crops, new crops. Once we have a better understanding, we can start moving from hazardous correlation to a cause and effect relationship, understanding that fertility has been damaged by the polluting agent on the pesticide, for instance. In the Netherlands, recently, the effect was shown of a neonicotinoid-type pesticide on bird populations. The population of birds have been affected in the Netherlands by this new pesticide, which has been in use for about 10 years. Ecotoxicity is definitely something we need to take into consideration. It has an impact on insect population and therefore indirectly bird populations, and we need to take it into consideration thanks to so-called participative sciences. Other effects are biological invasions. Biological invasions, that is, species which invade an environment, superseding indigenous species. Now, for biological invasions, we again have a problem of the cause-effect relationship. Is the invasive species the reason for the decline of indigenous species, or is the invasive
porteur de la mauvaise nouvelle, en l'occurrence,
system, the bearer of the bad news, telling us that the ecosystem is in trouble, disrupted, and that local indigenous species disappear to be replaced by opportunistic species. For instance, in the case of biological invasion, the problem is not so much the invasive species, but the fact that the ecosystem is being damaged. And eradication of the invasive species is not necessarily the good action. It may have a counterproductive effect because by eradicating the invasive species, we're going to disrupt the habitat even more, encouraging the arrival of other invasive species to the expense of the local indigenous species. Finally, the last threat is the climate change. Climate change has an important effect. We know that the threat has increased by 40% following climatic changes. Therefore, we need to take climatic changes in consideration, but doing this means that we have to do more than just preserve biodiversity, and I'm not going to dwell on that particular topic now. How do we counteract against all of these direct pressures? There is what we call nature-based solutions, solutions based on nature to manage ecosystems with the use of biodiversity and ecosystemic services. By reintroducing biodiversity and by taking biodiversity seriously in consideration, we believe that we will be able to preserve it and we will try not to artificialize the habitat and we will use less pesticides and less fertilizers and that we will be able to preserve the ecosystem's functionalities and biodiversity in general. Now, the next question is, what are the instruments, the social tools that we can use in order to counteract direct pressure? In this field, we have a number of controversies in progress. Scientists are delivering a message. They say we should have a neutral gaze on the problem. There are complementary actions, prescriptive actions, actions which all of the players are obliged to do things because of rules and regulations, but there are also encouraging actions. For instance, when people are being retributed for ecosystemic services, when farmers are being retributed, not in order to ask them to produce more meat, for instance, or agricultural products, but for them to be more interested and concerned by ecosystemic services. And researchers say that between prescriptive and encouraging measures, there must be complementarity. We're not pitting one against the other. We shouldn't say that we need more rules or more incentive measures, but that rather both should be used together in combination. When we set up social tools in order to preserve biodiversity, another problem arises. Do we want the state, the government, or possibly even the world government that should decide of actions to be imposed on local players, or should local players be allowed to organize themselves? And again, the message delivered by researchers is that the two should be complementary. We must have a national or global organization setting up rules, but local players should also organize themselves, and there should be a complementarity between the local and the national or world level. In conclusion, developed countries are developing virtuous actions to manage their ecosystem better. But unfortunately, the better they preserve their ecosystem, the more consumption of the northern countries will move towards the southern countries, which are not so well protected. Biodiversity will be protected in northern hemisphere countries to the expense of the biodiversity of southern hemisphere countries, which means that the result is not positive. We cannot simply reason on the national level. We have to think globally, taking into consideration the problems that all populations are facing across the world if we do want to preserve biodiversity over the whole planet.